graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Gun Culture 3, Blowback, Treasure Coast, by Ralph Cotton. Narrated by Colleen Delany and performed by a full cast. Fifteen stories up, on the balcony of the Oceana Princess II complex overlooking the beach, Harold Wright sat in a wrought iron deck chair with a flat briefcase lying on his shaky knees. He was nervous, far too nervous to be around these people, but there was nothing he could do about it now. Lately, being in business with Victor Trio and Ian Lambert, aka the Lamb, gave Harold a jittery, sick feeling down low in his stomach. He looked back and forth between the two men.
Jesus, what am I doing here?
Okay, it was his name, Harold Wright, on the business cards. Wright Way Venture Capital, Harold Wright, owner. It would also be his name on the engraved brass door plate if they ever had a real office door from which to hang it. As they were, they had been doing business from Victor's residential condo. He'd taken two Valiums the Lamb handed him earlier, but that hadn't helped either. All the Valium did was put a fuzzy glow around everything and make things seem to move a little slower. In the sharp sunlight, Harold looked at Big Victor Trio. Victor leaned back, 300 pounds of gristle and fat against the balcony rail, and blew a long puff of cigar smoke up and away on a coastal breeze. As Harold stared at him, Victor spoke to this newcomer, Eddie Van Gogh, who'd shown up only moments ago and stood facing Trio from a few feet away.
So, what's Stanley think? That I'm trying to stiff him or something? Sending you down here?
Eddie Van Gogh smiled, an easy sort of smile that didn't give much away. He looked around from Victor Trio to Ian Lambert, who stood a few feet away on the other side of him. Lambert stared at him real hard through coppery, bloodshot eyes. Across the balcony, Victor's bodyguard, Bones, an ancient Cuban, sat staring through his blackout shades. A semi-automatic shotgun rested on his knobby knee. Eddie Van Gogh shrugged, looking back at Trio.
Let me be clear. I'm not a debt collector. If I was, and Stanley thought you were stiffing him, I wouldn't come knocking on your door, would I?
Up one side of Van Gogh's loose white shirt, a flashy green and gold deco palm tree pressed against his chest and fluttered in the warm breeze.
Stanley wants his money. Think of me as an extra sort of personal VIP service, come all the way down here to pick it up from you.
Yeah? A VIP service?
Victor stuck his black cigar back in his mouth and glanced at the Lamb. Harold Wright watched, trying to swallow a dry lump that had settled into his throat, his Valium losing its kick. He didn't know how much longer he could be around people like this, people who acted like this, who talked this way, people with nicknames that sounded childlike, yet sinister, dangerous people. Victor once told him that back in the day, he'd been known as Victor the Bull. Thinking back, that was the day Harold should have left. Just dropped whatever was in his hands at that second and made a run for the door. Should have, but didn't. The money was too good. Victor tried to outstare Eddie Van Gogh for a second, but Van Gogh didn't appear the least bit put off. Seeing it, Victor turned, shook his head, laid his hands along the steel balcony rail, and spoke back over his shoulder to Harold Wright.
Little Harold, give this monkey 30 bucks. Get him out of here before he upsets me.
Sunlight shot off his diamond ring like some mini laser beam. The breeze nipped at his wide shirt collar. Of course, Harold Wright knew that bucks meant thousands in these guys' language, and at that moment he had less than $40 in change on him. He squirmed a little under his briefcase.
I'm afraid we'll have to make other arrangements, Mr. Van Gogh. $30,000 is a rather large amount to be carrying around.
He smiled, but Van Gogh saw a nervous twitch in there and smiled right back at Harold Wright.
Make that 38 bucks.
The hell you talking about? Where do you come up with this 38 figure?
8,000's the vig. Should have taken care of the gambling debt sooner. Beat all the extra charges.
Ian Lambert kicked a deck chair out of his way and moved toward Eddie Van Gogh.
You got some balls. Come barging in here over some two bits.
Victor raised a hand, stopping him.
Hold it, Lamb.
Seeing that this Eddie Van Gogh hadn't backed an inch, wasn't going to, it appeared, he just stood there smiling, both hands deep in his trouser pockets. This guy was cool. You had to give him that.
Come on, Victor. Say the word. I'll put this punk in the wind and see how he flies.
He gestured a big red hand out past the balcony rail, him and Van Gogh standing face to face, inches apart. Van Gogh still wore the loose, easy smile, but his eyes looked different now. They'd turned flat, resolved, like at any second now he might coolly, calmly take the Lamb apart, dismantle him where he stood. But then Van Gogh cut his gaze away from Lambert, real slow, craned up a little on the balls of his feet, and gazed out over the rail. He looked a long ways down at the beach, at waves rolling in, at tiny people moving around down there half-naked.
Ouch.
He smiled again, looking back straight into the Lamb's boiling eyes. Lambert almost lunged at him, but Trio stopped him again.
I said hold it. This is between me and Stanley the Pole.
Lambert still boiled, but he took a step back. In the far corner, Bones had raised an inch from his chair. Now he eased back down as tempers settled. Harold Wright sat biting at the inside of his lip, struggling to keep his nerves at bay.
What can I tell you, Mr. Trio? Nobody in their right mind would have taken Baltimore in six. Now, if everybody's through scaring me, pay up and we'll forget all this. Stanley's still your friend, but a debt's a debt. Everybody pays the poll, you know that?
A tense silence fell, and a coastal breeze whispered across them, warm and steady. Harold Wright sweated his Valium, or whatever it was, off, and had gone completely flat. He glanced from one to the other in this gathering of madmen. Victor, formerly called the Bull, his 300-plus pounds of bulk standing on stick legs. Ian the Lamb, tall, raw-boned, Scots-Irish headbreaker, red-gray hair curling every which way. Bones, an ancient Cuban bodyguard looking like a skeleton, with sunlight sizzling on his blackout shades. All of this felt like some bad dream. And in their midst now, this Eddie Van Gogh, confident, half-smiling, his feet planted shoulder-width apart like some young Sinatra ready to break into That's Life. After a long, tight second, Victor Trio flashed Lambert a glance and rolled a big thumb at Van Gogh.
You believe this guy? He tells me nobody in their right mind takes Baltimore in six. Little Harold, bring Mr. Van Gogh over to your place tonight. Give him $38. Christ almighty. Baltimore and six. I must have been out of my friggin' mind.
Harold Wright sat staring, going over what had just happened. Some of it real, some of it, he wasn't sure. Even the parts that were real, he couldn't fully believe. He tried to recount the entire scenario to himself, seeming to have gone blank for a moment as it actually happened. Harold had been in the middle of a meeting with Trio and Lambert when this Eddie Van Gogh fellow had shown up out of nowhere, telling Victor Trio he'd come here to collect a gambling debt for some bookie named Stanley the Pole. He opened the conversation by saying,
"Let's not dick each other around."
Nobody spoke that way to these guys. Maybe he should talk with this Van Gogh tonight when he came by his house for the money, see if he had any advice for him. He sure needed to talk to somebody. When Trio told Harold to bring him over to his place and give him $38, Harold had shakily come up with a business card, scribbled his home address on the back of it, and gave it to Eddie Van Gogh.
"I'll expect you around 10?
Owner, financial advisor, and accountant, huh? Yeah, 10 o'clock then."
He snapped the corner of the card with his thumb and slipped it into his shirt pocket behind the fluttering deco palm tree. Still smiling, he'd gazed out across the ocean, taking his time now, closing his eyes against the warm breeze.
"Nice weather, huh?
Anything else I can do for you today, Mr. Van Gogh?"
"Yeah. You guys live down here year-round. Maybe you can tell me something?"
"What's that?"
"Well, I'm only here a couple of days. I'm wondering, what's the best sunblock for this time of year?"
He rubbed his left hand up and down his right forearm. Again, the smile. His right hand still down deep in his pocket.
I'm asking for a friend.
Get your ass out of here.
Ian stepped away, knowing the guy was only breaking their balls now that he had delivered the message. Victor gave Van Gogh a flat stare. Yeah, this Van Gogh guy is cool. Like he'd said, he was no debt collector. Victor believed him. Stanley the Pole was known to hire the best, and Van Gogh had been right. Everybody paid the Pole. Victor let the sunblock remark go, but Lambert picked it up.
You wanna get rid of sunburn? Get a bottle of scotch and lay out on the beach all day. More sun'll sweat it out. Toughen up your system.
His voice was a little slurred by alcohol. Van Gogh just gave him a look.
Mr. Van Gogh, we get this debt settled. You tell Stanley not to quit taking my action, huh? We go back a ways, Stanley and me. You let him know we're okay, right?
Sure, like I said, he's still your friend, Mr. Trio. He wanted his money. He didn't hear from you? What's he gonna think?
Van Gogh lifted his right hand from his pocket for the first time since he'd arrived. The weight of a pistol pressed down slightly in his pocket behind the pleated summer gabardines. He spread both hands now, a young Sinatra making a breezy exit.
Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure.
Van Gogh took a step away, waited as Bones the bodyguard got up to follow him to the door. Ian Lambert tossed back a shot of scotch and let out a whiskey hiss, clenching his teeth.
Van Gogh, huh? Like the guy who painted the pictures and stuff?
Yeah. Except I got two good ears.
I'll remember you. Mr. Eddie Van Gogh.
You do that, and I'll remember you, Mr. Sheep.
Islam, you punk. Nobody calls me a sheep. Now, you get out of here.
His face swelled red again, neck tendons standing out tight.
Yeah, I got it. Lamb, sheep, whatever.
With that, he turned to leave. On the way to the door across through the living room, Van Gogh whispered over his shoulder to Bones, who walked along a half step behind him.
Bones, are these guys for real?
Yeah, they're for real.
Jeez. Then you might should have told this chump nobody was taking Baltimore in six last year.
I wasn't here last year.
What's this guy Harold on?
Volume, they're telling him, who knows?
Yeah, who knows? Hey, suppose I want to reach you. I can still find you at Teensy's?
Yeah, for now. Drop by. We'll catch up.
Will do. I might want some good advice down here.
As Van Gogh opened the door to leave, Bones said in a whisper that sounded like the quiet hiss of a snake.
Good advice. Go home soon, Eddie. You won't like this heat.
Out front of the Oceana Princess 2 complex, Eddie Van Gogh had taken notice of a white service-style van that had been sitting there when he had first walked inside. A simple plastic sign on the side of the van announced, JW Home Cleaning Company, by the room or by the hour. On his way out, the van was still sitting there, its engine running, no one in the driver's seat. There was something else, something that wasn't right about the van. He couldn't say what, but it would come to him. Without looking more closely, he walked three rows past the van and got into a dark green Pontiac that sat with its engine also running.
So? How'd it go up there?
Van Gogh's backup man, Lou Stuckey, sat behind the Pontiac steering wheel, AC blowing full blast and beads of sweat standing out on his red forehead.
Everything's cool. These guys are friendly enough.
Good. So, you got Stanley's money then?
Tonight.
Tonight? Man, I knew I should have gone up and cracked this guy's head. What, did you push him for it?
No, that's not how Stanley wants it handled. He wants to keep this guy's action. Evidently, the guy spends big. Let's get you back to your room. You don't look so good.
Well, forget how I look. I think cracking the guy's nuts the way to handle it. You've been up there all this time, the guy jerking you around. I'm down here burning the hell up. You and Stanley are worried about this chump because he's connected, is what I think.
You're wrong, Lou. This trio's not connected to Traficante's people down here. Traficante leaves this treasure coast wide open. The rest of the state is his. These guys are just a couple of indie operators.
Yeah? Even more reason you should have straightened the guy out. Let everybody know you don't dick Chicago around.
Nobody could tell Lou Stuckey anything. Eddie wasn't going to try. As they passed the home cleaning van, Van Gogh glanced over at it.
Bingo.
Now it came to him what was wrong. There was no phone number on the side of the van.
Got ya.
He settled back in the seat.
It wasn't the right time or place to straighten anybody out. These guys are bugged.
Well, how you know that?
Stucky glanced at him and gunned the Pontiac over into the far lane. He didn't feel like explaining about the white van.
Anytime you're talking to these big independent blow dealers, always figure somebody's listening.
Yeah, right. Like you're telling me something I don't already know? I think these guys shook you up is what I think. Bet you didn't mention about the sunblock like I asked you to either.
Lou, do you realize how weak that sounds, asking these guys about sunblock?
Screw them! I'm burning like a freaking grilled pork chop! Well, so you didn't ask?
Sure, I told you I would. I asked them, but I don't believe what they told me.
Well, yeah, what's that?
This guy Lambert says the best thing for sunburn this time of year is to get back out in the sun with a bottle of scotch for a few hours and let the sun sweat it out of you. Sounds crazy, don't you think?
Sweat it out, huh?
Forget it, though. This guy doesn't know what he's talking about. You don't sweat out a sunburn.
See, you've been here 2 days. You already think you know more than the locals?
If it was me, I'd forget the scotch. I'd get soaked in vinegar and stay in the shade. That's what I'd do.
I'd go around smelling like a pickle for the next week? No thanks, smart guy.
Then do what you think. No way I'd get back out in the hot sun with a sunburn. No matter who told me to.
Scotch. I wonder why scotch.
Stucky tilted his head, still considering it, and drove on. After escorting little Harold Wright out the door, the Lamb walked back out on the balcony, smiling and rubbing his hands together. Victor clamped his teeth down on the cigar and puffed it.
So, what do you think?
Scared out of his mind is what I think. You want to know the truth? I figure he's good for maybe another week before he starts wanting to confess his sins to somebody.
Yeah, me too. About a week. Less than that, if you run out of the crap you've got him living on. So, that's another thing we gotta deal with.
Yeah, but don't worry. I've got him on a string. I told him if you make a move on him, I'll come take him away.
I wanted him to pick up some of that private blow for us coming in through Jamaica. But maybe it's not a good idea. Get rid of him. Tonight. Give him a few hours. Let him get good and high. Then drive him over to Crazy Terry's tonight. And send him out on an airboat ride.
What about his wife? Think he tells her everything?
Yeah. What he doesn't tell her, she figures on her own. A sharp lady like her. You never met her, have you?
Nah. Harold always keeps her out of sight whenever I'm around. He must figure I'll go up her skirt or something. You told me she's a knockout.
Yeah, she's a knockout. But whack her too, just in case. Make sure he pays this punk Van Gogh the $38 first, so Stanley the Pole don't drop my action.
Yeah, no problem. I know you want me to get the key he's wearing, huh?
Yeah, the key and the box. Be sure to get them both. We gotta gather our stuff in closer to us. Things have been getting too loose.
If you like running over to Spano's, getting something to eat. They're making that yellowfin pizza, you know, with the pineapples and that.
Yeah, why not?
Victor turned and walked his big chunky body back inside the apartment. Bones stood up, followed him in, then sat down in the chair in a corner and laid the shotgun back over his knee. The Lamb stood in the middle of the room with his hands in his pockets, rocking on his heels, while Victor stopped and looked all around the room.
So, where's my jacket?
The Lamb looked around with him, shrugged, and looked at Bones. Victor flagged his hands at his sides a little.
Maybe I wore it to the can and left it there.
Bones' head nodded once real slow, as if giving permission, and Victor walked into the bathroom, found his sports jacket, and lifted it off the hook on the wall.
I don't like the Pole sending down this guy Van Gogh to stretch me for that $38.
Yeah, some nerve.
The Lamb had moved over behind him, right outside the bathroom door, listening, watching Victor check himself in the mirror, getting his thin linen jacket straight. A corner of the jacket's rear vent pleat turned under, so Lambert reached inside the door, smoothed it down, and stepped back.
Yeah.
So, be sure you get him paid off tonight and get him out of here. He strikes me as the kind won't go along with nothing. You seen those kind?
Victor reached down, picked up a hairbrush, and ran it back along one side of his head. He stopped and looked at the Lamb in the mirror.
Oh, yeah. hard to deal with.
Lambert grinned and nodded, glancing over at Bones, then back to Victor in the mirror.
Well, forget about that guy. I'll take care of him.
Right, by paying him. I'm telling you, we gotta be careful with this guy.
Why is that? He's not a made man, or he wouldn't be working for Stanley the Pole.
Nah, it don't matter that he's a made man or not.
Yeah, but if he's a made man, we couldn't lay a finger on him. Ain't that what you always say?
You ain't letting me finish.
Laying the brush down, something came across his mind. He tried to remember when he came in here earlier. First, he'd taken out a cigar.
Nothing to finish. I get it. If this Van Gogh gets in our hair, I'll take care of him. Same way I'll take care of little Harold and his wife.
Yeah, those two gotta go.
Victor stopped and thought about something again. When he'd come into the can earlier, he took a cigar out of his jacket pocket. Right. And the jacket was... where? He looked all around, again.
Yeah, that poor Harold. He really thinks you're some kind of big shot. A member of some mafia family or something.
You mean I ain't?
Now he remembered. His jacket had been laying across the arm of the... He glanced around the bathroom. The shiny tiles. No carpet, no wallpaper, no cloth furniture here. Nothing that would stain.
Nah. I've been watching, checking you out, Victor. You're nothing. Letting a punk like this Van Gogh come in and bump you around for a gambling debt. You've had people fooled. But not me. Not anymore.
Victor heard the click of metal across metal and looked wide-eyed into the mirror.
Bones! Bones!
He had just started to duck away when the lamb's first shot hit him in the neck and slammed him against the toilet. He staggered sideways.
Bones!
His blood spattered on the tile wall when the next shot hit him. Shot after shot, the silenced 9mm bucked in Lambert's hand as he walked Victor backwards to the open shower door. The sound was more like that of a high-powered BB gun than a pistol shooting high-grained steel jackets. The action of the slide making more noise than the shot itself. As Victor swayed backwards through the open shower door and slid down the tile wall, the lamb stepped in close and put the seventh round right above his ear from a foot away, holding his palm above the pistol, shielding his face from the blowback. Then he reached in, yanked the thin gold chain with the key on it from Victor's neck, and dropped it in his pocket. He stepped back, took the silencer off, dropped it into his other pocket, and pitched the pistol inside the shower. Snapping the surgical glove from his right hand with his teeth, he flushed it down the toilet.
So, what do you think?
He stepped out of the bathroom, looking himself up and down for any blood spots or bone fragments.
About what?
Bones didn't move a muscle. He sat staring through the black shades, the shotgun still across his knee, only with his finger across the trigger now, and the safety off.
You got this taken care of?
The lamb nodded toward the bathroom.
Yeah?
There was no breath in Bones' voice. His words were barely more audible than the rustle of curtains in the breeze.
Got a good saw?
Yeah.
Got a trunk? Some suitcases?
Yeah.
Some plastic?
Yeah.
Take care of that mirror?
Sure, everything. Leave it to me.
Okay.
The lamb nodded, adjusted his trousers up under his shirt, and pulled out three flat-bound stacks of new $100 bills.
So, you want it all in cash, or you want some in product when we get it?
I don't want no product.
Bones sat still as stone. His thin lips hardly moved when he spoke. His gaunt face revealed no more than the black lens hiding his eyes.
What? You don't want to invest with me?
Bones shook his head real slow.
You gonna see to it this Van Gogh from Chicago gets paid? You don't want to screw over the pool.
You kidding me? That was Victor's debt.
You didn't listen, did you?
Listen? To what?
To what Victor was telling you right before you clipped him.
Forget about Victor Trio. You want in on this or not? Cash now, or some of the action down the road?
Bones shook his head again.
I told you. Give me cash. I don't want this action down the road.
Around 4 that afternoon, after listening to Lou Stuckey's voice for as long as he could stand it, Van Gogh went out strolling along the beach. At a 7-Eleven type beach store with used surfboards lined up for sale, He bought a large bottle of white vinegar and strolled back to the Surfside Motel. When he arrived, he found Loose Ducky snoring drunk out on the balcony of his adjoining room. Van Gogh picked up the empty Dewar's scotch bottle, sat the vinegar bottle down in its place, and draped a couple of soft white towels across Loose Ducky's blazing red chest. He shook his head.
Poor bastard.
Back inside his own room, he sat on the side of his bed and called Stanley the Pole to let him know where things stood.
I don't like it. You going in there alone tonight? You be sure to take Lou with you next time.
I can handle this myself, Stanley. Fact is, Lou ain't feeling so good.
What's wrong with him?
It's his first trip south this time of year, you know? He got out yesterday and got himself burned.
This time of year? Are you kidding me? Hey, tell him I said he's going tonight and ask an order. That's why I sent him to back you up, because these guys get frisky. And whether you like Lou or not, he's good backup.
Nothing against Lou, but you should see him, Stanley. He looks real bad. Compared himself to a grilled pork chop. Poor bastard. He laid out in the sun again today, and man, he looks like a big neon tomato.
Again? That idiot! Doesn't he know better than that?
I told him not to, but you know Lou. This guy Lambert says it's the best thing to do, so he did it.
The lamb? Wait. He listens to what Ian Lambert tells him. You don't turn your back on the lamb, you got that? One reason I sent Lou along is because of the lamb. The lamb is from here in Chicago, you know. Nobody here will give him the time of day.
You told me that. Don't worry, the lamb's got nothing to do with this. I'll take care of this without any problems, so you don't lose Victor's action. That's the way you want it, right?
Not if it gets your face shot off. You take Lou with you tonight.
I will, Stan. But with that van watching everybody, I don't want Lou going nuts over the least little thing, start shooting or something. Besides, I'm only meeting with their financial advisor tonight. What can go wrong?
Yeah, with these guys, anything can be a setup. I like Trio's money, but with the lamb around, I don't trust that snake.
Neither do I. But let me just get in there, close this thing out real quiet-like for you, and come home.
Okay. Do what you gotta do. Get my 30 bucks and get out of there. Drug dealers always got the law circling over them. Sunburn, huh?
Man, I've never seen one this bad. I was hoping you'd tell me to send him home on a jet.
Now, if it gets any worse, you do just that. I don't want him out there screwing something up because he feels bad. All right, take charge of this for me, Eddie, all right?
I'm on it, Stanley. You'll hear from me.
While Van Gogh and Stanley the Pole had talked on the phone, Lambert was calling Harold Wright at his home. The lamb was already making his takeover. He had shaken down Victor's apartment, found the fireproof safe box stashed behind a wall mirror in the bathroom, and taken out close to $300,000 cash. Not a bad piece of walk-around money, but what he really needed wasn't there. He needed the bank box that Harold Wright kept for Victor, the one with the keys to all the safety deposit boxes held by Right Way Venture Capital. There could be a couple of million operating capital in them, enough get-out-of-town money to really get out of town. The boxes were full of cash and on-demand bearer bonds. How much? He didn't know, but a lot. Lately, the money had gotten so huge and hard to keep track of, him and Victor had left all the headwork up to Harold. All you could do with money this large was keep it moving and make everybody around you think you still knew the total. The other thing he needed? He needed the names of the middlemen connections, the guys who kept the dope moving. He also needed the shipping order number for the huge shipment coming in from Jamaica any day. Victor Trio thought he'd kept his connections a secret, but the lamb figured it out. Now it was all his. That afternoon, he'd made a few calls, let a few heavy buyers know that the product was coming, and that Victor had turned the whole product operation over to him and skipped the country. Trio had already paid Bones $5,000 to pick up the 28 keys of Blow. $5. He couldn't believe it. $5 to handle 28 keys of Blow. And to think that at one time old guys like Bones ruled the streets. But that was yesterday, and yesterday's gone. Nobody would question Bones picking up product. He'd done it so many times before. It might take them a while for everybody to figure out Victor Trio was dead, but what would they care? The money would be in their hand as usual. Bones was the only one who knew what he'd done, but he'd never open his mouth. Besides, Bones would soon be on his way back to Havana, going to spend what time he had left watching baseball and sipping wine. If his suppliers ever asked what happened to Victor Trio, come to find out Victor didn't have all the protection he'd said he had.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.